This program documents D-Day in the words of its soldiers. It features rare archival footage collected from a worldwide search and now presented in high definition. Many scenes are violent and viewer discretion is advised. Previously.
The anti-aircraft fire was so intense, it was unbelievable.
Lieutenant just yelled,
"Are you ready?"
And out the door we went.
The lowering of the ramp is like a signal for every German machine gun to open up on our boat.
We started going over the side. I dropped everything to avoid being drowned.
The boat to our left blew up. We were showered with body parts.
I heard an unmistakable rumble coming towards us.
I was in the third wave, and there's firing going on all over the place.
They needed many replacements like me for the men killed on Omaha Beach.
It was like opening up the gates of hell and just stepping in.
We made it off the beach and up to the foot of the bluff. It was like a swampy area with water up to almost to your knees and mud. We reached a crossroads and some of us were laying in a ditch next to the road. All of a sudden, machine guns started firing on us, and the lieutenant sent some people out to flank them. Private Mac Evans, 17 years old from Clarksburg, West Virginia. Well, me and two of the 1st Division men got separated from the rest of the group. And we didn't know where they were. And it starts getting dark.
One of the guys from the 1st Division said, "Well, what are you gonna do, Evans?" I said, "I'm gonna dig in somewhere because I'm not gonna walk around in the dark out here with the Germans everywhere."
14 hours after D-Day began, the longest day is far from over. For almost 3 years, Hitler's war machine has ravaged Europe. Now, the American-led Allied invasion is underway. D-Day, the goal, liberate Europe from Hitler's Nazi regime. Along with the British, Canadian, and other Allied forces, American planners spend over a year preparing for the surprise assault on the beaches of Normandy, France. But all too soon, they realize the German defenses are much stronger than anyone had anticipated, and the first hours come with huge sacrifice. It's the first night in Normandy, and the beginning of many anxious nights before the D-Day mission is complete.
Our battalion was about 500 yards off the beach. I was there in my little foxhole all by myself. They're not designed to make you feel good. Private Donald Van Ruzen, 19 years old from Newton, Massachusetts. I listened to all the sounds of the night, and if there weren't any, I imagined them. My curiosity
was supplanted by this feeling of being all alone. The only people around you were your fellow soldiers and the battalion.
The next morning didn't start well. I was at the edge of a field, and a rifleman came up beside me. He decided he was going to go to the other side of the field to complete a defensive line. And as he walked across, a sniper shot him in the stomach.
And I'm about 12, 15 feet away from him, and he's gritting his teeth and trying to not cry out. But I could see that he was hurting badly. And I started to go out for him, and I got a bullet very close to my right hand. So I thought, that's not a good idea. So I said, I'm gonna try to get some other people here. I need somebody to give us covering fire. And he said, just hurry up. And so I tried to get somebody to come over. It took too long. He died right there in front of me. That was the first inclination of what war was all about. That was not a good feeling at all.
The D-Day invasion begins on the beaches of Normandy, France. The mission objective is to gain control of the major roadways in Normandy. The key to success, the crossroads city of Saint-Lô, some 20 miles inland from the beaches.
For as intense as the casualties were on the beaches of Normandy, the fighting inland to Saint-Lô is going to be even worse.
Almost every road goes through Saint-Lô. So if you are to advance out of Normandy and deeper into France, into the heart of France, and specifically to Paris, you almost certainly have to have Saint-Lô.
The plan for the Normandy invasion was to get to Saint-Lô in a relatively short amount of time. That plan goes right out the window.
The men aboard the USS Augusta must get the D-Day mission back on track. Day-to-day operations are orchestrated from the battleship, where General Omar Bradley keeps a watchful eye on his troops.
By the morning of June 7th, we were not yet out of danger. Commanding General Omar Bradley, United States First Army. On the thin 5-mile sliver of Omaha Beach, we had fallen far short of our D-Day objectives. German artillery still pounded the beaches.
I didn't die like many in my landing craft, but I almost bled to death from the 4 different wounds I received on that first day. Private Harold Baumgarten, 19 years old, from Brooklyn. An artillery shell ripped off my left cheek.
My upper jaw on the left side, a hole in the roof of the mouth, my tongue was cut, and a machine gun bullet had took my lip away and took away my upper jaw. Both jaws were gone, and teeth and gums on my tongue.
But there was this ambulance coming down the road. I flagged it down, and they put me on the floor, and I fell back. And my helmet hit the metal floor, and I heard one of the ambulance drivers say, "This guy just passed out."
I didn't pass out. I was too weak to sit.
He took me all the way back to the beach. There was 12 of us laying on the sand in stretchers. All of a sudden, snipers opened up from the top of the bluff. They started killing the wounded and the aid men. I knew they had telescopic sights because one aid man got a bullet right through the Red Cross on his arm. When they came to me, they put a bullet in my right knee.
They wanted to torture you, but the next one was going right through here. But just then, the destroyer McCook came offshore, scraping its bottom on the sand, and its 5-inch guns, they fired at the bluff, so I was saved again.
While the Allies collect the wounded, on the outskirts of the beach, the German 352nd Infantry Division is regrouping. Responsible for yesterday's massacre on Omaha, they've been bloodied, but they still have plenty of fight left.
Yesterday, we narrowly escaped from Bunker 72 before the Americans overran it. Crawling back along ditches, we managed to link up with the rest of our unit. Grenadier Karl Wegner, 19 years old, from Hanover, Germany. I was sent to this farmhouse to get some more ammunition. There was handed about 1,000 rounds of mixed tracer and regular rounds. I grabbed them and ran back to the beach. My friend Willy Schuster and I managed to stay together before we are a complete machine gun crew. Our commander was killed yesterday, so we have a new one. He told us that our mission now was to hold the Americans until other troops arrived.
When I arrived in Normandy, I was taken to a trench where we were to spend the night. There were a lot of dead Germans in that trench. Private Peter Thomas, 19 years old, from Pensacola, Florida. We were always nervous.
We didn't know what was going to happen. And I was a replacement, which I wasn't with any outfit, because they needed replacements after the beaches. And it was this major sitting behind a desk. He said, how would you like to join the MP platoon? I didn't know what that meant, because to me, MP meant military police. He said, no. It's a different. You would be directing traffic, taking prisoners, and you could be assigned for many different things, and often alone.
As the replacements file on shore, the D-Day wounded move in the opposite direction.
I had to wait several hours on the beach before these four Navy men picked up my stretcher. They took me out to a ship, and with ropes, they got me upside of the ship.
Laid me out on the deck. Now, all this time, I thought we lost the battle, because all I saw was dead bodies. I looked up and I saw this huge U.S. flag. And then I knew that we didn't lose.
In the first 36 hours of D-Day, Harold Baumgarten is wounded 5 times, barely alive by the time he is loaded onto a hospital ship. He's among the lucky. But for thousands of Allied paratroopers still lost behind enemy lines, evacuation is not an option.
The paratroopers' job is to contain the Germans inland from Utah Beach. They've got to open up all the causeways through the floods, hold the crossroads, and just pave the way ahead of the forces landing on the beach later on. So their job is absolutely vital. If the paratroopers fail, then essentially we lose D-Day.
We landed about 18 miles from our drop zone in an area that wasn't even on our maps. John Hinchcliffe, 23 years old, from Park Rapids, Minnesota. We could see a church steeple with a cross on it,
miles away. So we thought, well, that has to be high ground. So we made our way towards it. And it was daylight by the time we got to the village of Grenier. Guys kept coming in. We ended up with about 170 men. There was a little argument amongst the officers whether we should try to find our way back to our objective or if we should stay there and wait until our own armies caught up with us.
The paratroopers in Grenier, like those misdropped all over Normandy, are miles away from their targets and carry limited ammunition. And the one advantage they held, the element of surprise, is about to be compromised. The Germans have made a shocking discovery aboard a shattered landing craft on Omaha Beach.
I must say that never in my entire military life have I been so impressed as in that hour. Lieutenant Colonel Fritz Ziegelmann, I held in my hands operational orders for the American landing forces.
The fighting inland to St. Lo is about to become even bloodier than the beaches.
And he put the ground 2 inches away from my heart.
That was the worst carnage that I had ever seen.
You didn't know where the enemy was up there.
The violence was, you just can't describe it.
Fighting grows more savage as it moves inland and into small villages. French homes change from German to American, then back to German hands. During the chaos, German soldiers discover Allied documents, which they deliver to intelligence officers.
Our men had already found operational plans in a landing craft on Omaha Beach, Lieutenant Colonel Fritz Ziegelmann. Now, less than a mile off the beach, a briefcase secured to a dead American officer. In it, a second set of plans. Now we knew the entire American invasion plan.
Behind enemy lines, American paratroopers head towards their mission objectives, unaware of the breach in intelligence.
And now General Kreiss of the German 352nd knows every objective they're going to try to take, their main timetables, troops, elements, everything. He knows what is going to happen from that point on.
The mission for the two American Airborne Divisions on D-Day was to seize critical roadways. because the Merdare River was swollen. It was 10 miles long, and in some places, it was 3 miles across. It was one giant lake. And one of the only places that you could get across that lake was the bridge at La Fier.
We managed to make our way over a bridge at a town called La Fier. We were supposed to take control of the bridge and set up a perimeter to keep the enemy from crossing it and reaching the beach. Lieutenant Johnny Moore, 25 years old, 507th Parachute Infantry Regiment. All of a sudden, we could hear the engines and the loud clicks of the tank tracks.
Tank track, the metal tank tracks. And then the artillery falling on the road junction, it was quite clear that they were ranging in for a concentration of fire on that road junction.
The paratroopers are only lightly armed. Facing down tanks would mean certain death. They retreat back over the bridge.
By the time we reached the church on the west bank of the Merdare River, the Americans had already been driven back to the other side. Sergeant Gerhard Win Ecken, 19 years old, 91st Luftlande Division. I'd fought in Russia for 3 months. This war was very different. In Russia, we always knew where the enemy was. They were right in front of us. In Normandy, the Americans were in front of us, behind us, right and left. And it was the same for them.
I heard the captain screaming to the radio operator, "If that anti-tank gun doesn't get here soon, we're dead meat." The troops from Utah Beach were supposed to relieve us within a few hours, but there was no sign of them.
Just as the paratroopers are about to be overrun, they receive backup from heavily armed reinforcements.
American airborne divisions were not just paratroopers. They also, importantly, made use of gliders. Now, the paratroopers weren't heavily armed, and they didn't have a great deal of equipment with them. So the glider provides an ability to bring in heavy equipment and heavy supplies.
They brought in 57-millimeter gun, and they knocked out these tanks.
That night, we regrouped. I remember thinking, hey, I'm alive, didn't get hurt too bad, and we advanced the mission. Things aren't so bad. But we had no idea what the Germans would throw at us the next day.
In general, the American soldiers weren't any older than us. They seemed well-trained and well-equipped. But was their fighting spirit as good as ours? I dashed forward with my platoon. The battle for both sides was very hard and very bloody. Half the men in my platoon were wounded.
During a lull in the fighting, Johnny Marr is sent out on a two-man reconnaissance mission. Purely by luck, they make an astonishing discovery.
We went out to the northeast edge of the perimeter area, and we saw large stones of crushed rock that rose out of the water. Sure enough, it was a road.
Marr reports the road to his commanders, who decide to capitalize on the discovery.
So the plan was that an entire battalion would maneuver around in a flanking maneuver, a Hail Mary pass, if you will. They would follow a cobblestone road that had been built by the Romans, and the Germans don't even know it's there.
We waited until night and made it across the river without a problem. Even got across the highway. But as we tried to turn left through a churchyard, things started to unravel. Almost immediately, we hit their booby traps.
These were the warning devices the Germans had put up, so we lost all our surprise at that point.
Behind the La Pierre farm, we could hear the Americans trying to move along a ditch to stage an ambush.
I could hear them shouting commands, and I knew they were moving their guns to get us in a crossfire. I didn't understand a word of German, but if that were me, that's what I'd be doing.
The Germans lay in heavy fire. Marr's group is pinned down.
One of our guys, Private First Class de Glopper, he was a BAR man, Brownie automatic rifle. I think it was about 30 rounds before he had to reload, and so he just opened up
on the Germans with that BAR, and he kept walking forward, just shooting, until they killed him.
De Glopper is the only man in the 82nd Airborne to earn the Medal of Honor in Normandy. His sacrifice saves the battalion and allows them to regroup with the rest of their unit. But they're still on the German-held side of the bridge.
By now, the sun is up. We knew our ambush had failed, but we knew something had to be done to finish off the attack.
That something suddenly comes from the Allied side of the bridge.
At 10 a.m., the glider infantry regiment conducts a direct assault across the causeway. Most of them don't make it. The Germans sweep the area with intense machine gun and mortar fire. To clear this stalemate, the 507th Parachute Infantry Regiment then push across the causeway.
Our soldiers ran the bloody gauntlet across that causeway. 800 yards, nowhere to go for cover. Charging the Germans who were on higher, drier ground. Yet they did it.
It was an act where many people had to say, I'm going to get there, or I'm going to die.
Over 560 men are killed or wounded in what becomes the costliest small unit action in U.S. airborne history.
Of the 30 men I originally commanded, only 8 were left. Gerhard Winneck, 91st Luftlandedivision. We were low on food and ammunition. We decided to avoid any more bloodshed and surrender. At 19 years old, the war ended for me at the La Pierre farm beside the Merdere River.
Now the Allies control the bridge at La Fierre and the route inland from Utah Beach. But despite the victory, the Germans have a tactical advantage that the Allies know nothing about. The captured operational documents detail the Allies' every move.
General Price knows what the American troops are going to try to obtain for objectives in the 352nd sector. They're going to attack this village next. So you get every troop you can, get over to that village. That's what Price did, leaving big holes in a line. We could have walked through many, many places, but we didn't do it because we were keeping to our plans, which they had.
But one of the greatest obstacles in Normandy is one that the Allies don't have a plan for, and it will cost them thousands of lives.
The Germans knew that every attack was in their favor.
You didn't know what you were going to run into.
Nobody was prepared. They were practically impenetrable.
Mac Evans is back with his original unit, the 29th Division. New to combat, they're trained to take the beaches of Normandy. But what lies beyond the beach will take them by complete surprise. And it will cost thousands of lives.
Nobody was prepared for the hedgerows. From the air and the
photographs, the military thought, well, they were like English hedges, which wasn't true. And they were practically impenetrable.
They were like walls, 12 foot high maybe. And there were big trees growing out of the hedgerows themselves. Gave excellent cover for German machine guns. It was perfect defensive positions. Terrible offense.
You had to go slow everywhere you went. I mean, you didn't go charging anywhere. Very few people went charging anywhere without getting killed.
If you were gonna go through there, God help you. You had to work at it, and by that time, every German from a mile around heard you and was ready to shoot at you. If we got half a mile,
we considered it to be an outstanding success. So there was a learning curve to take the next hedgerow.
The German 352nd Infantry Division has been in Normandy for months, creating tunnels and machine gun positions in every hedge along every field.
Our mission now was to hold the Americans until other troops arrived. To do this, we would dig in where we were and use the hedgerows in our defense. Grenadier Karl Wegner, 19 years old from Hanover, Germany. Our commander showed us how to position our guns in the hedgerows. We learned that the hedgerows were our allies. We made every field a fortress.
In the corners, there would be openings, and the Germans set up machine guns to fire through these openings.
You couldn't see the gun. All of a sudden, it would start firing.
They were so dense that they dampened all the noise around you. I was struck by the silence. We couldn't really hear anything on the other side of the hedgerow. We began to get a feeling of isolation.
Many times, we'd have a battalion within 300 yards of us, and we never knew they were there.
From above, the situation is different. Allied air power far exceeds German Air Force strength. And through nonstop bombing raids, the Allies rule the skies.
It was always the same. Dive into the ditch and keep your head down. For the most part, it was useless to shoot back because they were gone as fast as they appeared.
During the day, Allied airstrikes pummel key roadways. The Germans hold their positions in the hedgerows and wait for the Allies to cross their path.
They can only move at night. So we're grinding them up with our air power and our artillery, but they're grinding up our troops, trying to get through the hedgerows.
The Allies attack one field, then the next hedgerow, then the next field. It's a pattern that will continue for weeks. As they make their way to the D-Day mission objective, the German-occupied French city of Saint-Lô.
D-Day is only the beginning. It's the first step, what I often call a foot in the door of Hitler's Europe. What matters most is the campaign that's going to follow that gets you all the way into Germany.
For as intense as the casualties were on the beaches of Normandy, the fighting inland to Saint-Lô is going to be even worse.
Getting to Saint-Lô and all the way to Germany will only happen if the Allies can deliver a constant flow of supplies to the front. Stockpiles of weapons and ammunition cover every last inch of space in the UK. But landing it all in France is another challenge for the Allies.
It was all Churchill's idea. He said, when we do the invasion, we can't rely on seizing a French port, so let's bring our own harbors with us.
They're called Mulberry Harbors, and the Germans don't even know they exist. They're an ingenious design of concrete blocks, steel platforms, and floating roadways. They will create an unloading advantage never before seen in warfare.
It was all gonna be towed across by little tugboats and put together like some big jigsaw puzzle. I mean, it's just amazing. They were huge. I mean, the caissons that made the outer wall of the Mulberry Harbor, they're like the equivalent of a six-story building and the width of a football field.
The Mulberry Harbors are assembled at Omaha and Gold Beaches. Each one can move 7,000 tons of men, machinery, and munitions every day. But overwhelming supplies only make a difference if they can be moved inland to the front. And hedgerow country is preventing that from happening.
The American mindset was based around numbers, around putting more replacements, more reinforcements into battle, overwhelming the Germans, and this was an advantage of the Americans, but it wasn't always going to help you. If you were simply throwing more people towards one hedgerow opening that was covered, you were just simply consigning more people to death or wounding.
We had been going since 4 o'clock in the morning. It's now 2 o'clock at night. We were dead. When we stopped for whatever reason, after a couple of seconds, you'd hear a crash, and somebody had fallen asleep and fallen over on his face. We were that tired.
We got to a place to stop for the night, the Carrefour, the crossroads. So Andy Hansen, the squad leader, and I went into the field and set up our machine gun position. There was nobody around. I had a sick feeling that something horrible was about to happen.
Then again, it got quiet. And the funniest thing happened to me. I knelt down. And I felt that I felt the presence of of the Lord, and I knelt there for a short time, and something seemed to be telling me that I'd be all right.
But for many in Van Rusen's unit, this would be their last night. The German 352nd Infantry Division that devastated American forces on Omaha Beach has moved inland.
Sometime after midnight, we stopped abruptly and were ordered to take cover and remain silent. Corporal Kalb went off to see what was going on. He came back out of breath and whispered, "There's a large group of Americans camped right in front of us." So we were ordered to attack. I squeezed the trigger, sending out a long burst. Corporal Kalb yelled to move forward. We had caught them in total surprise.
I heard firing, but I didn't know where it was coming from, so I fired three rounds, and then the gun jammed. I couldn't do anything. And then down the road
came two Germans, and they got about 20 feet away, and they could see I was struggling with a machine gun, so they stopped firing. They both had Schmeissers, machine pistols. Damn if they didn't run over and pick up the machine gun, tripod and all, and run off with it. And there, Andy Hansen and I were left looking at each other with no machine gun. Scared the living dickens out of us.
To this day, Don Van Rusen doesn't know why he was spared at La Cara 4. When the fighting stops, the Germans take some 30 Americans prisoner.
Kalb came over towards me while I was guarding the Americans. He told me something shocking. We were to shoot the prisoners. I protested and said that I would not do it. To my surprise, Kalb ordered me to shut up and make the machine gun ready to fire. The lieutenant and the rest of our group moved off, leaving just us and the Americans. Then I was given the order to fire.
After a surprise encounter with the German 352nd Infantry Regiment, American POWs are marched out into the open. German commanders order Private Carl Wegner to do the unthinkable.
We were to shoot the prisoners. The lieutenant and the rest of our group moved off, leaving just us and the Americans. Then I was given the order to fire. But into the empty ditch on the opposite side of the road. I and everyone else were very relieved. The prisoners understood what we were doing. Then Kalb said, "Bitte quiet, wait here, Americans come soon." Then we turned and ran down the road.
The Americans at La Cara 4 got lucky. That might not have been the case had they been prisoners of a different type of German soldier. One that was just now entering the battlefield in Normandy.
During the Second World War, the Germans developed this entirely separate fighting force called the Waffen-SS. Waffen-SS units were not present in Normandy at the time that the invasion began. But from June 6th, Waffen-SS units began converging on Normandy.
The Waffen-SS soldier was a young, highly trained, highly motivated soldier that had the latest equipment with him. And these soldiers had grown up under the Nazi system, and they were fighting for their leader till the last drop of blood. And this made the SS soldiers so dangerous.
In response to the attack on Normandy, Hitler sends his most lethal fighting force to the beaches, the Waffen-SS. Their primary mission is to stop Allied forward momentum by preventing the beach forces from linking up and creating a massive front. On their way to the beaches, the SS will travel through the village of Granier, where a ragtag unit of paratroopers has been encamped since the D-Day misdrops.
It was a Sunday, and I'm Catholic, so I went to church. About 20 minutes after the service began, this French woman burst through the doors. "The Germans are coming! The Germans are coming!" They hit us, and with what we estimated to be a battalion, 500 men. I ran to my machine gun.
My machine gun was probably 300, 400 yards away, and they hit us in strength, and did a lot of damage to them. Wholesale slaughter. They didn't kill any of my men. Well, they finally pulled back, and they had the local people take a cart with horses and pick up the dead and wounded. Naturally, we wouldn't fire on them.
Then about the middle of the afternoon, they hit us in strength again. Same thing.
They hadn't learned their lesson the first time. And we mowed them down.
The small group of paratroopers manages to hold off wave after wave of attacks, but more German forces press into the village.
When they made it past my machine gun position, I looked at Patrick, my assistant machine gunner, and he goes, "John,
you better get the heck out of here." So I said, "Well, okay, I'll take the machine gun, you grab the tripod and the ammunition." And we ran down the hill probably 100 yards or so, and I looked at Patrick and said, "Where the hell's the ammunition?" He left it back. So I said, "Well, cover me and I'll run back and get it." So I ran back up the hill, picked up the two boxes. I looked up and there was a German at the top of the hill, about another 100 yards from me.
Then he opened fire on me. Well, I took off down the hill as hard as I could run. He's just hitting all around me. I get to the bottom of the hill and dive headfirst into the hedgerow, expecting Pat to take him out. But he had picked up the machine gun and gone on down the trail.
So I just grabbed my rifle and my musette bag and stuff, and this guy was still running down the hill towards me. So I took him out. And then I took off after Pat.
Hinchliff escapes, while more German troops, including the Waffen-SS, storm into Granier. They discover a group of wounded Americans, unable to flee with the other paratroopers.
We had about 32 guys that were wounded. We had them in the church. And of course, we were relying on the Geneva Convention for them to take care of our wounded. Well, these were SS troops. Well, they didn't take prisoners.
The SS marched the wounded and two medics to the back of a field.
The SS initially was a political organization as well as a military organization. So in order to be in the SS, you had to be a party member. You had to be a true believer.
For the SS, the life of an enemy soldier was worth nothing. To them, an enemy was not considered a human being.
The fighting in Granier delays the SS from reaching the coastal city of Carentan. After 4 days of fighting, Allied troops moving up from the beaches begin capturing the city.
At 6 a.m. that day, we drove into the city streets to open the main road between Omaha and Utah. Omar Bradley, Commanding General, United States First Army. On our seventh day ashore, we had linked the Allied forces together in a beachhead 42 miles wide.
Carentan is in Allied hands. Now they advance inland in a massive, unified front. But the enemy is also surging forward. and SS units bring with them the most feared weapon on the ground. The Allies are about to come up against the infamous Tiger tank.
They were huge things. My machine gun would just be like a firecracker against them.
Their firepower was tremendous.
They'd scare the bejeebies out of you because you had no protection against tanks.
Almost a week after the D-Day invasion, the most feared German weapon on the ground begins bearing down on the Allies, the Tiger tank. Its armor is thicker than any tank ever made. Allied tanks can only break through it at close range. And the Tiger's 88mm gun is the most powerful on any tank in Normandy. The Allies are almost defenseless against it.
There were rumors a German Tiger tank division was heading in our direction, which made everybody nervous. Private First Class Peter Thomas. We had our own tanks, Shermans. And the Sherman tank
was a great tank. And the one thing it had was speed, maneuverability. But against one of those huge, monumental Tigers, nothing could strike terror into your heart if you came across one of those things. And it always pained me to see the tanks come by and all these young guys sitting on top of the tank, and you knew they were going into combat. Sometimes they'd yell out, the MPs are winning the war. But you'd know they were going into combat, and you wondered how many would be alive tomorrow.
American tanks move out to support British armored divisions. The British have been unsuccessful in taking their June 6th objective, the coastal city of Caen. Its roadways are vital to the Allied push inland, but German Tiger divisions have blocked all routes leading into the city. Now, new Allied intelligence has identified a weak spot in the German line, dubbed the Caumont Gap. The British will sweep around to the west of the city, through the gap, and into Caen.
But interestingly enough, at this stage of the game, because of the captured operations orders that they got on D-Day, the Germans know the flank is wide open and that there's going to be an attack through there. Allied intelligence said there was nobody there.
The order came through to move out. I knew that the Americans were just 4 miles to our right. Other than that, I had no idea what to expect. Lieutenant John Cloudsley Thompson, 23 years old, from Sandhurst, England. We were told that there were no German tanks in the area. We heard they were miles away, stuck in the hedgerows and out of petrol.
In fact, Waffen SS Panzer divisions are heading towards the Caumont Gap, and one of Germany's most feared commanders is leading the charge. Michael Wittmann is one of Germany's most successful tank aces, with over 100 known kills.
I had no time to assemble my company. Instead, I had to act quickly, as I had to assume that the enemy had already spotted me and would destroy me where I stood. Obersturmführer Michael Wittmann, 30 years old, from Vogeltal, Bavaria. I set off with one tank and passed the order to the others not to retreat a single step, but to hold their ground.
Many Allied tank crews in Normandy have only been together on training missions. For some, like Bob Mixa, it's their first combat experience.
We had earphones on because we communicated together on earphones, all five of us in the tank. So you didn't hear too much from the outside. You could feel the rumble of the tank. And you talk to each other, but you don't know about combat until you experience it.
British Commander John Cloudsley Thompson is more seasoned. He tangled with the Germans in North Africa, but this is the first time he has faced Whitman. The British make it to the outskirts of Villers-Bocage with almost twice as many tanks as the Germans.
We stopped on the outskirts of town. I was tank number 2 out of 4 tanks. We were close together, about 15 to 20 yards between tanks. Suddenly, the tank in front of us burst into flames. No one got out.
I knocked out two tanks from the right of the column, then one from the left. Then I drove straight into the town.
The smaller German Tiger unit begins leveling the British.
I backed between two houses to get some cover and a better shot. Our tank had scarcely left the road before the Tiger loomed through the smoke less than 35 yards away.
I drove along the street, knocking out every tank that came towards me as I went.
We couldn't unscrew the gun lock, and this Tiger tank was only 15 yards away. I fired a 2-inch smoke mortar, but it went way over his head.
The enemy was thrown into total confusion.
The Tiger traversed its huge 88mm gun and fired. I felt my legs tingling as the shot passed between them. Flames licked over the turret, and my mouth was full of grit and burnt paint. "Bail out," I yelled and leapt clear.
The British retreat towards the safety of the beaches. The Americans turn back before even engaging in the battle. The Germans reinforce their line and close the Caumont Gap. Michael Wittmann's Tiger destroys as many as 14 tanks, 15 personnel carriers, and 2 anti-tank guns, all within the space of 15 minutes.
A handful of SS with Tiger tanks was actually able to stop a whole armored column, tanks, tracked vehicles, and this sent a shockwave through the Allied troops that led to the fear of the Tiger tank.
Despite the devastating defeat, the worst is yet to come. A blow from above that's about to cripple the entire campaign.
We had some horrific storms there.
We wiped out our air support. Nobody could fly in that gale.
All unloading operations have to cease.
800 Allied ships wrecked.
This storm meaningfully changed the Second World War.
The Allies have endured almost 2 weeks of non-stop fighting through the hedgerows, and they've only made it a few miles inland to their D-Day objective, the city of St. Lo. Living conditions and lack of food and sleep have added to their misery.
A lot of times we had to go off food for several days. One day, when we hadn't had any food again, a buddy of mine from Chicago, Bruno DeGella, says, "Hey, John, I saw a chicken."
"I saw a chicken running up the street." He said, "John, let's catch it and we'll fix it in our mess kits." So I said, "Okay."
The Germans must have had an observer or something, because we'd barely started up the street and shells started coming in. We'd hit the dirt and it would blow up and we'd get up and run. Still, we caught two chickens.
And I found some old moldy butter in one of the houses, and we fried up that chicken. Thanksgiving dinner.
But most meals at the front aren't very appealing.
K-rations with a little package, with a little can of, like, sardines or something as meat, and you had a little chocolate bar. Once in a while, when we got in reserve, they brought up these C-ration. And C-ration was a can of Spam, and that was supposed to be a treat.
The company cooks, they couldn't keep up with us, so we mostly lived on K-rations, C-rations.
Allied supplies, food, and ammunition are delivered into Normandy by way of Mulberry harbors. Continuous operation of these ports is critical to the success of the mission. Now the harbors are about to come under attack, and not by the Germans.
Forecasters knew the storm was approaching. They just had no idea that the storm was going to be as big or as powerful as it was.
The Normandy coast, it's Atlantic, oceanic. There are storms all the time, but this was the worst one on record for about 100 years or something. And the problem is we weren't quite up to speed with all our reinforcements. The artificial harbours we were building were behind schedule, and so it just hit us at exactly the wrong time.
The Mulberry harbours at Gold and Omaha Beach begin to show signs of stress from the 20-foot waves crashing over them.
We awakened to an ominous wind, a leaden sky, and a cold, scaly rain that tore at the tent flaps. Omar Bradley, Commanding General, United States First Army. The channel had broken into whitecaps, and the surf foamed against the beach. Not until it was reported that unloading had closed down on Omaha Beach did we realize how serious this crisis was.
The only chance we had of keeping our landing craft from being beaten to bits was to anchor a long way off the beach, out in the channel, and hope we could ride out the storm.
The seas became so rough that the skipper was afraid that the ship would crack in two. He ordered mooring cables to be strung fore and aft to give extra support to the deck.
It was a deadweight business. Six of my men drowned.
It really paralyzes Allied operations in Normandy. All unloading operations have to cease, can't land reinforcements.
It's going to affect the soldiers fighting in the hedgerows because the storm has reduced the amount of munitions getting forward to the troops that are holding the line against the German army.
The other huge factor was Allies have no air power. They can't fly up in these bad conditions. So therefore, the Germans can use the railway system to bring up their reinforcements because for the first time, they're not in fear of being shot by the fighter bombers coming in.
He wiped out our air support. Nobody could fly in that gale. But more depressing was standing in the chow line. The constant rain dripping off your helmet, turning your mashed potatoes into mush. You tried to stay dry.
Just to live, to exist. And we would put sort of lean-tos over our slit trenches that were dug in at the base of the hedgerow. And they would leak after a while, but they were better than nothing.
When we went down to the beach on June 22nd to survey the damage, I was appalled by the desolation, for it vastly exceeded that of D-Day. The giant concrete caissons of the artificial harbors were now scattered across Omaha Beach. In 4 days, this channel storm had threatened Operation Overlord with greater danger than had all the enemy's guns in 14 days ashore.
The Mulberry at Omaha is damaged beyond repair, and the Mulberry at Gold is crippled for weeks.
By the time the storm is over, you're going to have 800 Allied ships wrecked or run onto the beach and unusable.
You've got a situation in the latter part of June, in the aftermath of this, in which ammunition is becoming at a premium. General Bradley is sending orders downward to his units saying, hey, you're limited to a certain number of artillery shells fired per day because we don't have enough of it ashore. Riflemen are running out of bullets.
With food and ammunition even more scarce than before the storm, the Allies continue the march to their D-Day objective, St. Lo. Now they are facing a reinforced enemy and pushing into thicker hedgerow country, where they hit one German trap after another. The casualty rate skyrockets.
We had a saying in the 29th Division, we're three divisions in one. We have a division on the front line, a division in a hospital, and a division in a cemetery.
The Allies have been in Normandy for over a month. According to the original D-Day plan, they should have already taken the crossroads city of St. Lo. But they're still some 13 miles away, and the casualty rate is soaring.
By July, the attrition of casualties, the terrain, and the demands for constantly attacking were seriously reducing our numbers. We must have had six different company commanders. Our original ones had been replaced
two or three times. So, and it was up to largely non-coms because the officers had been second lieutenants lasted 4 weeks at best. And we came up over a hill, and down to our left was the 116th attacking. And I had squad leader's binoculars, and I could see the Germans on a hedgerow firing at the 116th. So I had them set up the heavy machine gun right there on the open field, and started to zero it in. And all of a sudden, I got the most god-awful bang on the top of my head. And it hurt, and I came up ready to swing, and here's a captain. And he said, "You damn fool, out of action, out of action." And I said, "Sir, there are the Germans down there. There's my machine gun. Why should I go out of action?" And he said, "You don't go out of action, and I'll have you court-martialed right now." And I thought, "Well, sir, I guess I'll go out of action." Turned out he was the replacement intelligence officer for the battalion. And he was so scared of attracting fire to himself that he gave up one golden opportunity. I think the 116th would have blown kisses at me. I was going to make their job so much easier.
Without experienced officers leading the charge, the mission inland from Omaha Beach to St. Lo falls further behind schedule.
D-Day is not going to plan. And it's really the soldiers on the ground, the NCOs, the privates, even a few lieutenants, that have to make the tactical decisions.
The leadership is hit or miss. You can imagine, you're bewildered, you're scared, you're not sure what to do, where to go, maybe even how to use your weapon the best you can. Nothing's getting done. You're bogged down and you're losing a lot of people for no good reason. That's the nightmare of this whole scenario.
In the hedgerows, you're following orders. You're taking this hill and you're taking that hedgerow. Your villages along the road, you're taking this village, you're taking that village.
The Germans were waiting. They knew that every attack was in their favor. We were being banged this way and that way, and you got to learn to live with it.
We had got very used to the way the Americans would fight. Karl Wegener, 19 years old. First would come the artillery, and when that would shift to the rear, we knew the infantry would come, usually with tanks. Of course, the Air Force was somewhere above. We would fool them by putting out captured marker flags. They wouldn't shoot, thinking us their own men. Roads and tunnels had been cut through the countryside. When we did have to retreat, we would blow the tunnels behind us in order not to be followed.
They had a mine, they called it the Bouncing Betty, and we called it the Ball Buster. And it would jump up to about waist high and go off. So it hit right in the vital area of your groin.
I think you counted your days one after the other. Because there were so many people that were getting wounded and killed, that if you thought about it, you could drive yourself crazy.
Infantrymen desperately need support from Allied tanks, but the Allied tank commanders can't break through the hedgerows.
From inside the tank, it looks like a forest in front of you. They were so high, with trees and bushes.
And you had to get up over it. It was hard for us to advance because the Germans were on the other side of the hedgerows, and Tank tried to get up over his body. His belly was exposed, and that was the weakest part. With the German Panzerfest, or what they call them, they'd knock you out.
At this point, they're going to have to innovate and figure out a new way to deal with this problem. The existing opening in any hedgerow is obviously going to be covered by every German weapon in the neighborhood. So, what you have to do is create a brand new opening.
We ultimately reacted by taking these obstacles that the Germans had conveniently left out on the beaches for us, cutting them up with blowtorches, and then welding them to the front of tanks.
They would back away from a hedgerow and take a run at it. When those prongs hit, they could tear a path right through the hedgerow.
This monster, with large horns sticking out, could plow right through. It was a new tactic.
We just busted into these hedgerows and made our own path. American way, you know, we'd always find a way somehow.
The Allies start punching their way through the hedgerows, but to gain real momentum, they need to capture the major roadways that lead to St. Lo. American paratroopers are ordered to attack a German unit defending one of the critical roads.
Hill 95. We didn't know where the enemy was up there.
You're just waiting to get it because we were under such great odds.
That was the worst carnage that I have ever seen. Enough to make you sick.
The Allies are finally making progress through the hedgerows and moving closer to their D-Day objective, the city of St. Lo. In the final push, they move to cut off St. Lo from German-held strong points to the north. American paratroopers are sent to Hill 95, a strategic high point and key to controlling roadways into St. Lo. The Allies plan to take the hill in a coordinated attack from the ground and above.
This officer drew a diagram in the sand, and he told us that we'd have two dive bombers coming in.
They were going to drop their bombs real close by us. Everybody get behind trees or something, rocks or whatever you can, because shrapnel would be flying around. And he said, I'm going to blow the whistle, and we're going to go in at a dead run, and we're going to take this hill.
We got about 800 or 1,000 yards up
into that wood. We ran smack into the Germans' main battle position.
I jump over the trench, and there's a German at the bottom.
He was let loose with his automatic weapon. And I had a raincoat on the back of my cartridge belt, and he riddled that raincoat, and two rounds went through the seat of my pants and never touched the skin.
And then they started throwing grenades. And they were ricocheting up all the trees. One of them fell very close to me.
I put my head behind the tree, but that was the best I could do. And it took me along my left side.
It's one of the first major battles in Normandy fought with air support. And the Germans don't have a chance.
That was the worst carnage that I had ever seen. Those dive bombers and that heavy artillery opened up directly in front of us. That was just enough to make you sick.
With the help of Allied air support, the paratroopers take Hill 95, and with it, one of the major arteries in Normandy. After almost a month of fighting, the Allies finally push to within striking distance of St. Lo. But nothing could prepare them for what they would see.
Part of the Allied air strategy is to bomb small towns, not just because they're a congregation place for German troops, but by bombing those buildings, you're blocking the roads. You're making these arteries impassable.
St. Lo is absolutely laid waste. If you could find an intact structure in St. Lo by the third week of July, you were doing pretty well.
Allied forces move into St. Lo and take the fighting to the streets. But despite heavy bombing raids, they quickly find that the Germans still have a firm grip on the city.
The 352nd is holding in the north of St. Lo. It will not crack. It's got a tactical situation in hand. Its front line is compressed so that its troops are holding. It's got defense in depth. The US divisions are pushing into the city. They make a toehold, they get pushed out. There are instances of buildings changing hand many times. One house changed hands 11 times, fighting through the kitchen, fighting through the living room, back and forth, back and forth.
Their head-on attack fails, and the Allies are pushed out of St. Lo. They form a plan to sweep around from the northeast over a high point called Martinville Ridge.
By attacking the central hill on Martinville Ridge, it's going to make the rest of the German defenses worthless. Taking Martinville Ridge is basically opening the door to St. Lo.
The Americans are going to make one concerted push for St. Lo. It's going to be as bad as it could possibly be. It's the last chapter in an awful, awful mess.
We were getting down to 15 or 20 men per unit. We were finally relieved by the 35th Division. Just come overseas. We noticed immediately that they had presses in the uniforms and their faces and hands were clean, and it was impressive.
The battalion commander said, "Who's in charge?" And I said, I think I am, sir. And he said, "You think?" And I said, "Well, I haven't looked around to find out who we've lost today, but in this group, I'm in charge." And he said, "Well, where are all the foxholes?" I said, "Sir, we have foxholes for everybody that's here." He said, "Well, how many is that?" And I said, "I think the last count I had was about 35. That's out of 178.
It's been almost 2 months since the Allies landed on the beaches of Normandy. Now their D-Day objective is less than a mile away. The final battle for St. Lo is about to begin. Final battle to capture St. Lo, the objective of the entire D-Day mission, has begun. The Allies have been fighting through hedgerow country for almost 2 months. If they can take the crossroads city of St. Lo, they will finally break out of the hedgerows.
We moved out in three companies. We was in the center, H or J or something companies on the two sides
flanks. And we moved out on Martinville Ridge. That was a high piece of ground that ran maybe 2 miles outside of St. Lo. And we didn't know the two companies on the flanks had stopped.
Somehow we'd managed to slip right through the German lines. But we were just 200 of us with four machine guns, four mortars, and a radio. It felt like we were just sitting ducks. We radioed back for orders. We didn't have any food, we didn't have any water. The batteries on our radio were dying.
They can't reach the rest of the unit to find out why the other companies stopped or if reinforcements are coming. They do know that they are well within range of German heavy artillery.
We just waited out there, alone, waiting for the Germans to notice us and attack.
So we were out there all night by ourselves.
By the next day, our radio was dead, and we didn't know a task force was sent in and was going to try to get past us into St. Lo. They were a large group, much larger than ours, and they had tank destroyers, tanks, armor, everything, and they moved in.
They hit broadside. They hit in force.
The task force carves into the German defensive line and starts pushing down Martinville Ridge towards St. Lo.
The Allies put everything they can to bear on Martinville Ridge. They hammer it with artillery incessantly, put armor up there, they bomb it from high level. They keep knocking and knocking and knocking and hammering, and they're whittling them down.
But from inside the city of St. Lo, the Germans have their sights trained on the Allies.
Watching men approach to that telescopic sight was an eerie thing. Karl Wegner, German 352nd Infantry Division. I could see them yelling and pointing, moving forward as the inverted V of the sight swept across their bodies. I wondered what they would say to me if they knew I had them in my sights. Karl thundered out his order to fire. In seconds, I sent 50 rounds into the advancing Americans. Some fell, others went for cover.
The Germans cover the hill in machine gun fire and pound the Allies with heavy artillery.
A mortar round hit really close to where I was positioned. I was knocked out. When I came to, I could hear a popping sound. One of those hot fragments from the mortar had hit the ammunition and was setting it off. And those were the little pops
that I was hearing. And I looked at my jacket. The middle of it was shredded. And I looked out there, and there at arm's length was where the mortar landed. So that was about as close as I wanted to get that day.
Despite the high casualty toll, the large Allied force coming off Martinville Ridge begins to break the German defensive line.
The strain of combat was beginning to show on us. Corporal Kalb, the veteran from Russia, could see it. He said, "You can't sweat out every shell coming as if it were aimed at you. That'll drive you crazy." Looking me straight in the eye, he continued, "If it's your time, no matter how deep your hole or how good your cover, the game's over."
The Allied task force leads the charge into the city and starts capturing St. Lo.
And there wasn't two Holbrooks in that town. The city was completely destroyed.
Kalb said to me, "Karl, any fool can see that we are beaten. There is no hope of holding this lousy French ruin. If those fools with the oak leaves and crimson on their collars had any sense, they would have let us keep going until we got to the other side of the river. Or even better, they'd end the war before we're all dead."
We got up on the top of the hill and we could look down. And when the task force did their remarkable work of coming down Martinsville and got behind the German lines and held on, and they could do it if anybody could. They were the best regiment in the division, and they were brought down into the city itself.
The Allies move into St. Lo against a German army desperately clinging to the ruined city. The outcome of the entire D-Day invasion will be decided here, in the fighting through St. Lo's streets and blown-out buildings.
We moved out fast, running through the destroyed streets. We kept close to the walls and remnants of buildings for the best cover.
The Germans are on the run, but the fight is far from over. Their orders are to hold the city to the last man. The Allies have lost thousands of men fighting their way through the hedgerows to complete their D-Day mission in the city of St. Lo. If they can win control of the city, the rest of France will soon follow. After a successful assault down Martinville Ridge and into the city, the Allies have the Germans on the run.
We moved out fast, running through the destroyed streets. Karl Wegener, 19 years old. Then it happened. When Corporal Karl rounded the next corner, he ran right into a group of Americans and armored vehicles. Willy, my assistant gunner, wasn't able to stop quickly enough. Gunfire pierced the air, screams and shouts followed. The corporal dragged Willy by his boots back around the corner. His cries of pain sent shivers down my spine. I gave the machine gun to Günther and told him to fire at anything that came around the corner. The wounds were bad, so the lung and stomach. My God, how the corporal tried to save him, as if he were his own brother. The look on his face told me that. His face became sunken and lost its color. He knew he was finished. He stopped shrieking in pain and began to cry, softly. He looked at me with eyes one cannot describe and said his last. I never forgot it. Willy said to me, "Karl, through all this, just to die in the rubble, it makes no sense."
Soon after, Karl Wegener is a prisoner of war. 6 weeks after landing in Normandy, the Allies achieve their D-Day mission objective and take back St. Lo from the Germans.
But liberating the city comes at a huge price.
The citizens who are so excited about liberation everywhere else in the Normandy area are not as happy with the American troops as they enter because St. Lo has taken such a pounding.
It's absolute ruins. As one of the American soldiers will say, I think pretty famously, we liberated the hell out of this place.
Going through St. Lo, it was very difficult. Just unbelievable destruction. I've never seen such terrible devastation.
I mean, it was just flat. And I felt so sorry for the French people because thousands of them died during the Normandy campaign.
You knew it had to be done. They knew it had to be done. That was the only way they was going to get the Nazi boot off their throat. And you try to make it as painless as possible.
To us, moving into St. Lo was just another day. To somebody with a map and a grease pencil, I'm sure it made him very happy. General Gerhard could triumphantly report back to the Corps commander that he had taken St. Lo.
He had taken St. Lo. He had done his job. But I think we were getting more and more fatalistic. We recognized that, yeah, we had come to one of the major objectives. We had done it. We were alive. Thank God for that.
But the man credited for leading the task force into St. Lo wasn't so lucky. Major Tom Howey was not yet off Martinville Ridge when a piece of shrapnel pierced his lung.
Like most of us, I'm sure Major Howey prayed he'd make it through alive, but, well, he wasn't afraid to put himself in harm's way. General Gerhard had his body taken in after
St. Lo fell and put on the ruins of the church, of the cathedral, and had draped in an American flag.
The men moving into St. Lo passed Major Howey's body to pay their respects to the man who would go down in history as the Major of St. Lo.
One of the reasons he's held up as the Major of St. Lo is because of the esteem in which he was held by his fellow officers, certainly, but also by that ragtag group of men he had led under these terrible circumstances. He becomes kind of the symbol of the American sacrifice to take St. Lo.
Whereas on the other side of town, you have a symbol of defeat. There's a broken German kid in a ditch that gave his life for his country, the wrong cause, left in a hole. Two bodies, two very different outcomes in a city that's broken itself.
St. Lo has fallen. The Allies have secured their foothold in Normandy, and the D-Day mission is complete. Now a new way of waging war in Europe will begin for the Allies.
St. Lo is going to mark the end of the hedgerow fighting, and it's going to see the dawn of the breakout of maneuver fighting for the American Army.
The U.S. Army, in the summer of 44, is the most heavily mechanized army in the world, by far. It's designed for slash, dash, maneuver. St. Lo makes that possible.
With the capture of St. Lo and the hedgerows behind them, the Allies bring in the remainder of their forces, including the Third Army, led by legendary General George S. Patton. Within a month, the Allies liberate Paris. Within a year, they reach Berlin. Nazi Germany surrenders and Hitler is dead. Then, after serving and sacrificing for a struggle that changed the world forever, the men who survived D-Day could finally return home.
Well, naturally, it was wonderful. And we got discharged at Boston. I get in the train, and I'm coming into Camp McCoy here in Minnesota. And I'm looking out the side window, and here's Muriel standing on the deck. You can imagine. Hadn't seen her for 2.5, 3 years. And beautiful. She was a beautiful girl anyway. Want to see her picture?
When I got wounded, I came back by a British ship. By golly, I got to sit with a regular tablecloth and a servant. It had a lot of class, so I was grateful to the British.
So I was in Mitchell Air Force Hospital in Long Island, New York. So my hair was still growing back. I had no teeth in my mouth, in the front. I weighed 110 pounds from not eating. And my parents, they came out with my two sisters, their husbands, their children, and my mother walked right by me. I was on crutches, and she walked right by me, didn't recognize me.
Well, after St. Lowe fell is when I went to the hospital with pneumonia. So I was taken off the line, and they wanted to send me back to England, and I just refused to go. I said no, because I want to stick with my outfit, you know. For 50 years, I never talked about it at all. Then a reporter for the Times-Picayune, she wrote an article about me and two other people. And my children read this, and he said, why didn't you ever tell us about this, Dad? And I said, I was too busy making a living, and I just didn't want to talk about it.
For 34 years, I couldn't really get into the nitty gritty. You know, you'd talk about it a little bit, but I could never get into the nitty gritty of it. I lost almost all my men in the World War II. Lost 75% in Normandy alone.
It's hard to discuss and talk about it. I often wondered why them and not me, but that was our destiny, and a destiny that we had no control over. Some of the men died very young. They had never experienced life as it was meant to be, to have a wife and children. But they had to die very young.
The first time back to Omaha,
the cemetery, it was hard.
When I got there in 1988, and I went down to the beach, I was crying when I went down. Because I could picture each dead body and where they were laying. Bedford Holbach, Elmer Wright, Clarence Roberson. I knew where each body was. I said to my wife, nobody will ever know what they did, who they are, where they came from. I said, now I know why, one of the reasons God saved me. He wanted me to be their spokesman. So right then and there, I became their spokesman. That was in 1988.
In the end, D-Day lasted not one day, but 43 days. The total cost in dead and wounded, 220,000 Allied troops, 240,000 Germans, and 50,000 French civilians. Those who survived carry memories that never fade.
I'm just a farm boy from West Virginia. My name is Clarence Mac Evans,
and everybody called me Mac. I was 17 years old at that time, which the Army didn't know.
I don't particularly like killing people, but sometimes.
You have to think about it's either you or him. Lieutenant Johnny Moore, 25 years old, 1st Lieutenant, 507th Parachute Infantry Regiment.
My name is John Joseph Hinchcliffe, and like I say, I was
21 when I jumped into Normandy. To this day, I say thank you every night when I go to bed. and I'm kind of a hard man, too.
Private Donald Van Rusen from Newton, Massachusetts.
On D-Day, I was 18.
Private First Class Peter Thomas.
On D-Day, I was 19 years of age.
Bomb gun, Harold.
I was 19 years old on D-Day. Now I'm an old man of 88. And I'm here to tell my story to people and make sure that none of my buddies are ever forgotten what they did, where they came from.